the land is being taken, settlements are being built on Palestinian ground, and we are squeezed like a Swiss cheese. We are in the holes, surrounded by fences, walls, and so on. Now, we as a family here, we are affected by this situation, as many other Palestinian families, with land confiscation. And this piece of land was bought by my grandfather in 1916, during the Ottoman period. And during that time, the Palestinians, they were demanded to register their land in order to pay taxes to the Ottomans. So many Palestinians refused to register land. But my grandfather did it the other way. He registered the land, so this was unusual. And the second unusual thing my grandfather did, he lived on the farm in a cave. So he wanted his children to grow up here. And this is exactly what happened. So after my grandparents died, my father and uncle took over, continued farming the land, living in caves until they passed away. And we as children and grandchildren, we grew up with the same tradition. Now in 1991, as in different areas, we heard that the Israeli authorities wanted to confiscate the land to build a settlement. This is the only Palestinian hill that is without an Israeli settlement. So we challenged that, so we went legally, and to make the story short, we are still in court since 1991, struggling to keep this farm. 12 years in front of the military court, and now over 11 years in front of the Supreme Court. And the journey continues, so we are still, until today, struggling to keep this farm, with a financial burden of more than $170,000. Now, the outcome is that we are still here. We did not give up, and we are here. Now, Israeli settlers, they tried with physical pressure to move us out. So Israeli settlers attacked us between 1991 and 2002. They came here, they cut our trees, they damaged our water tank, they threatened us with guns, and they tried three times to build a road on our property in order to build a settlement. And we managed to stop all those road constructions by court. And the last time they came in 2002, they were digging for a road, and we stopped it legally after 3 days, and the settlers were very angry, and they damaged 250 olive trees from our property. And of course, as a Palestinian, you know how olive trees are important for the Palestinians. It's like a member of the family. And we were very frustrated, but 3 weeks later, we managed to plant new trees sponsored by a Jewish organization from the UK called European Jews for Just Peace in Palestine. They heard about our story and they sponsored trees and they came and planted them. This was a big sign of hope for us. Against violence, against sitting down and crying, and against giving up and leaving. So what to do? We were stuck. We needed to develop a different way of resistance. So we said, before starting a new way, we said four important things that became our principles. First thing we said, we refuse to be victims. Secondly, we said we refuse to hate. So we are respecting the humans as humans, but we have to tell the other what you are doing is wrong. Okay. Are you with me?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thirdly, we want to walk the talk, to believe and do. And fourthly, we said we are people who believe in justice, and one day the Son of Justice will rise again. So after we said all of that, we started a new way of resistance, a non-violent, a creative, a constructive, a positive way of resistance under the slogan, we refuse to be enemies. So the question was, how could we develop the farm without water, without electricity, and without a building permit? So for example, for electricity, we installed a solar power system, the first in Palestine in 2009, and now we are totally independent in terms of energy.
That's really good.
Wow.
And we managed to save, since a couple of years, more than 45,000 euros for fuel expenses. We used to run a diesel generator a couple of hours in the night. Now we have 24 hours of electricity. Okay. So this is the creative, you know. Secondly, with water, how can you do farming and, you know, invite guests and so on without water? So we are depending on rainwater collected in systems. And now we are filtering the gray water to be used for irrigation. And for building, we are not allowed to build on the ground. We started renovating caves. And this is one of seven caves renovated. As you see here, it's a nice cave. And the paintings were done by kids during one of our summer camp. And the title was Peace, Justice, and Conservation of the Creation. So we started thinking about the different types of programs to bring people together. So every year, we do a tree planting campaign. And we invite people to sponsor trees, and we invite people to plant trees. This year, we are planting 5,000 trees on this property. Yeah. For us, when we plant a tree, and of course, we invite people, we invite Palestinians, anybody is invited to plant trees. When we plant a tree, we believe in the future. Very important. Yeah. Because when you plant a tree, and especially in this very dry climate, it's not an easy job to do. Maybe you think it's digging a hole and putting a tree and that's it. No, you have to water each tree by hand the first two summers, twice a week at least. It's a lot of work. Yeah. But then the tree will find it, you know, the roots will find their way into the ground, and the tree can survive. Mm. And this is exactly, you know, you believe that this tree is going to bear fruits. Secondly, you protect the ground, you protect the environment, and you protect the land from the danger of confiscation. And also we learn that peace should grow from the bottom and up. You know, we always talk about peace, but making peace is difficult. Show me how to walk this path towards peace. And I don't want you to explain to me how wonderful peace is. I want to explain to me how to get to that point. And that's why it's important to say peace should grow as an olive tree from the bottom and up. You need the ground for peace. You need the foundation for peace. You know?